And hello, everybody. Welcome to another edition of the Shabbat Show. So great to be with you again. I miss you guys. We were just a minute ago was Purim, and the world has, I feel like it's been like a river between last week and this week with all that's going on. It's great to be back with you again. Hope everyone had an incredible Purim. And I hope that now we are into the season of spring, the season of redemption, as you say, miracles. We're moving. This is the period of time that is of the most exciting periods of time in the Jewish calendar. There's a rule, there's a law that whenever there are 2 months of Adar, Purim falls out in the second of the two, because we're trying to link the salvation, the redemption, the connection to God that took place in the miracle of Purim, and that which is coming up, the miracle of Passover. So this is our time. It's an honor to be with you, and I thank you so much for joining me today on the show. Today's an incredible show. It's a special show. It's very close to my heart. Around, I don't know how many years ago this is, but I was 19 years old. And a close friend of mine, Rabbi Yaakov Gibber from Boca Raton, had basically somehow got me into Camp Hask. Camp Hask is the Hebrew Academy for Special Children. It's a camp. And I had no intention of going. I had no intention of spending my summer that way. And to be honest, I was completely convinced that I was not up to the task to spend the summer with children of special needs. Somehow he finagled it and convinced me, and I ended up on a bus to Camp Hask, Parksville, New York. And if I tell you that it was the most difficult summer of my young life, I wouldn't be in any way exaggerating. It was by far the most difficult summer of my life. But it was the most meaningful. Something happened in that camp that changed me as a human being. There was something about spending time with children with special needs that brings something out in you that you never felt before. There is something very special about that community, very holy, very spiritual. And to me, it changed me. I like to say that I did a lot with it, but I didn't. I'm a regular, normal guy. I wish I did more with my life. But at that moment, it changed me. It changed my values. It changed what I was going after. Since then, I came back. I got involved in another great organization called Yachad. And my love and respect for people of all types, but in particular, children with special needs, it'll never leave me. The incredibleness of every human being, but the impact that the special needs community had on me and on so many others. And tonight's a show highlighting the greatness of the special needs community and all those around it. And there's so many great organizations. The Center down in Deal, New Jersey. Oh, well, others, so many others. There's so many incredible organizations out there. And there's so many families and so many people. And there's such an incredible piece of our community. And we got a great show for you tonight. We're going to meet Rabbi Judah Michel, who is the director of Camp Hask. We're going to meet parents of a special child, the Sokolovs, the rabbi and Rebbetzin. We're going to meet Bracha Lavrinov, who's a life coach, who has an incredible story. We've got great music videos. We've got a great show. And of course, at least my highlight, we're going to meet our special guest of honor, Rachel Gray. We've got an incredible show. It's something that I know will touch you as it has me. And as always, please give us a shout out over here. We love wishing you guys Shabbat Shalom. It's an honor when you guys are on, and it gives all of us that feeling that we are one big community together. So please put Shabbat Shalom's here. When we get to the Kahoot later on, we're going to talk about it, and we'll be able to wish everybody Shabbat Shalom's from wherever you're from. So please, wherever you're from, if you're not with us on Zoom, that's fine. Wherever you are, just go to my Facebook page, Charlie Harari, and put it there. You don't realize that when you say Shabbat Shalom from so-and-so, there's someone else in the part of the world that goes, wow, that's awesome. When we go from Toronto to Los Angeles to Texas to Germany to Australia, it brings it all together. So please, we'd love to wish you Shabbat Shalom, and we'll hopefully get to it to Kahoot, and Kahoot's on its way as well. So it's going to come a little bit earlier this week. So get ready for it. Go to Kahoot.it or download it on your app, because it's going to be awesome. So you got to play Kahoot and compete with your family. We've got a lot of great feedback from the past 2 weeks. Actually, 2 weeks ago when we did that special Project Inspire edition. I don't know about you, but some of the feedback, the whole weekend was awesome. But I guess the most consistent feedback that I got was new people came to the show and they were like, what? You can compete every week with the people in your house? I'm like, yeah, it's part of the fun. They're like, this is incredible. So don't just start getting ready now for Kahoot. Why not? Maybe you'll place this week and you'll place higher than you ever expected. All right, let's begin the show. It's going to be amazing. Stick with us all the way to the end. And thank you so much for joining us on the Shabbat Show. Of course, we want to thank today's show. It's sponsored by the program of the Carl Enoch Goldman Center for Jewish Values. And we thank Jay Goldman for his consistent sponsorship and partnership. We thank you, Jay, for being a partner in this show. This is also dedicated by Hershey and Leah Mendelson in memory of Leah's mother, Chana Bas Avram Perlstein, on her first year at site, which is coming up the 3rd of Nisan. All right, everybody. My first guest is Rabbi Judah Michel. He is the executive director of Camp Hask, the Academy for Special Children. He is the Mashpi of NCSY, and he lives in Ramat Beit Shemesh with his wife, Ora, and 8 children. I had a chance to catch up early in the week with Rabbi Michel. Check this out. So share with us a little bit about your role and your feeling about Camp Hask.
Thank you. It's so good to be with you. My role in Hask is really an evolving role professionally. And it's really an incredible merit to work with such a dedicated team of professionals, lay leaders, volunteers from the community and beyond. We're all focused on one thing, is to provide 8 weeks of respite for families and just an experience of love and care for individuals with special needs. It's being a part of something where the goal is to create a level playing field where everyone is able to participate and be respected and empowered for their abilities. What they can do is something that I don't take for granted. It's inspiration every single day.
What have you seen in terms of the development of the community's perception and understanding of this community over your tenure, over these many years?
It's something which, as a community, we're all growing together. The more we get to know each other's needs and each other's strengths, the more we're able to be there for one another and for each other's families. It's an extraordinary time to be alive. There's more happening. There's more thoughtfulness and there's more sensitivity. And there's more opportunities for all of our kids and all of our friends and neighbors to be involved in the professional workplace and educational institutions and in recreational experiences and in summer camps. So yeah. Camp Hask is one of the better known, let's say, or one of the larger programs for individuals with special needs. And we work together with an incredible amount of different programs within the community to make sure that everybody's taken care of. I mean, that's what it is. That's what it is to be a community. That's what it is to be a family.
And what have you found? I mean, I as you know, I was a counselor in Camp Hask, and the experience changed my life. Share with me, if you can, just how Hask sees the world and why, in a way, it's a microcosm of how we should all see the world.
What's most rewarding is that sometimes people, you know, I love watching it when kids come into work. When I say kids, I mean, you know, college students and graduate students, and come in to spend the summer, and they think they're coming to, you know, do some chesed, you know, some community service and help others and lend a hand to someone in need. And this incredible bond that's built between campers and counselors, direct care, and how the friendship develops on such a human level. Yeah. Of realizing that, like, we are all in this together and we all need each other. Some have, you know, these strengths and some have those strengths. Me, I've just I know that at the end of the summer, anybody who's in the capacity of being a volunteer or professional in our program has received so much more and grown exponentially more and is leaving so much more fulfilled and enriched and receiving more than they ever imagined giving over the course of a summer.
Yeah, I completely agree with that. I think you're absolutely right. I think it switches very quickly. It takes you a while to get into that. It switches quickly. And I wonder, and this is, I wonder if it's a spiritual material thing, which is when you live in the material world, someone else tells you what's more important, who's winning, right? And you grow up in a world where like, they tell you like, here's the race and let's see who's winning. And like, you're always winning some race. You're always going for some communally accepted trophy. And you get lost in that. That like these people are winning. And I guess if you make it to like a screen level, then you've really won. Or if you get a lot of stuff, then you really won the prize. And then you, from a spiritual level, from a God's perspective, it doesn't really work that way. And I can tell you from my perspective, what for me working with the special needs community did was it reminded me that there is no winning in this world. Winning, as it's not about winning. And there's nobody in front of somebody else. Like each person is created in the image of God in their own way. And one's not better than the next. One's not higher than, there's no treadmill that we're all running on. Like it doesn't, that's not how he sees it. And I want your perspective on it, but I think it took me a while to come to grips with that. And then as soon as you do, and you get out of that material way of seeing the world, like it's almost as if like you get to put on in a way like God's glasses or spiritual glasses. And when you do that, the whole world changes.
Being in an environment with kids with special needs or individuals with developmental disabilities, we learn very quickly that it's not about changing or fixing. It's about accepting each other for who we are and where we're at and seeing each other for what we can do and our strengths. And that being enough. And when we have that kind of acceptance of self and others, that leads to real love and then real relationship, as opposed to competitiveness and like earning and winning and going forward. And we see that all summer. And that is the key to real happiness, yeah. To real fulfillment and real joy. And that's true inspiration.
Yeah. Herb, thank you so much for joining us on the show. And thank you for what you do. And Hask and for our entire community. And may God bless you to keep on shining your light on this world.
Thank you. Thank you. And it's a pleasure to be in the Shabbat Show. Hope everybody has a Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat of peace and connectivity and helping one another and making sure that we stick together.
Amen. That was Rabbi Judah Michelle. I got to tell you, I loved the whole thing that he said. And I enjoyed the interview so much. But what he said at the end really stuck with me, which is this idea that it's about acceptance, what it's like to accept another human being for who they are and to love them for who they are. Imagine a world like this. Imagine like a world like this. It's God's way of seeing the world, to look at somebody else and accept them for who they are. Just want to play a quick video about Camp Hask. So for those who are not familiar with it, you get a good sense because we're about to introduce an incredible person who is a part of Hask as well. But just before we continue, I want to play a quick video about Camp Hask and the work that they do.
I'm a one-way motorway. I'm a road the driver way follows you back home. I'm a street light shining, I'm a white light blind and bright, burning off and on. It's times like these you learn to live again. It's times like these you give and give again. It's times like these you learn to live again. It's times like these, give and give again. It's times like these you learn to love again. It's times like these, time again.
That was a little bit about Camp Hask. Times like these, you learn to love again. It's times like these, you learn to love again. So it's really what it's all about. That's what this is all about. By the way, can I tell you something? That's what Shabbat is really all about. Taking a breath, looking at the people for who they are, seeing it from God's perspective and appreciating the people in our lives. We run and run and run. God's like, slow down. Look at this world that I keep. Look at these people. They're awesome. They're made in my image, all of them. Even the ones that don't look like you. I'm telling you, it's the gift of Shabbat. It's the gift of this show. It's the gift of the show. I mean, the show about special needs community. It's the gift of this community to us. You know, I asked Rabbi Michelle to introduce us to an amazing, interactive, wonderful camper. I wanted someone we could bring onto tonight's show, and his response was Rachel Gray. And I had the opportunity to catch up with Rachel earlier this week, and boy, was he correct. It's an honor to share with you the interview that I had earlier this week with Rachel Gray. So Rachel, thank you so much for joining us on the show. It's an honor to have you on.
Oh, I'm loving it so far right now. I can't wait.
So I remember, do you go to Camp Hask in the summer?
Yes, I do. Yes. And
tell me about it. What do you love most about camp?
Oh my gosh. Basically, all my friends, all my counselors, they just teach me different things and I just have a blast.
Yeah. Isn't it amazing?
Yeah.
What do you find? What does it feel like when you get there? Tell me what it's like when you first get to camp and what that feeling is like when you have a whole summer in front of you.
That's a really good question. I would say the learning experience, because I like to learn a lot. Yes.
That's great. That's exactly right. So what do you do during the day?
I actually get to do different classes during the day, and I go on Zoom, and I get to do my Melton class, which is learning about my ancestors at night. And I also get to do my exercise. I also get to basically have a wonderful time.
That's great.
Yeah.
And what is your favorite hobby?
My art, my singing, my dancing, and speaking of singing, I am taking a singing class and I'm loving it.
That's amazing. It's incredible how many things that you're involved in. How do you keep up with everything?
Basically just living life, having a wonderful time doing it.
I love that. You know, there's a lot of people watching here. And one of the things that I want to make sure people understand is what it's like to be nice to other people. What have you learned about that? And what do you think people can do to be nicer to each other?
Okay, so I think growing up at camp was not just an experience, it's a lifetime. You grow up learning about different wonderful things in life. And it shows you how honest, how to cherish other people with wonderful charisma and wonderful, beautiful nachas, and just having someone there to say, you know what? I'm so glad you're here. It's nice to meet you. You are just a beautiful star. It shows you how grateful you are in life.
Yeah.
So for me, learning about August in camp, it's showing my Mishama, that I can be a good person because of it.
Yeah. And it's so right. It's so right that when we see each other as stars, it makes us want to be stars. It makes us realize who we are.
Yeah.
That's incredible. Who makes you feel like a star the most?
Funny you should say that. All the boy and girl counselors and my friends, my family, and basically all the division heads.
Amazing. It is. How important is it for all of us to have people around us that support us for who we are?
Wow. What a powerful thing to say. I would say it's amazing, wonderful, and a great experience in life to learn. And I'm thinking what else I should say. I'm so nervous.
You're doing amazing. You're one of the best interviews I've had in a long time.
I actually pictured my life like, how can I put this for you to understand? So when I'm at camp, I'm like the Hannah Montana. When I'm at home, I'm just Rachel. So it's just a wonderful thing.
Yeah, so true. Well, I thank you so much for joining us on this show. Thank you for taking the time to give us this interview. And we're just so happy that we can connect right now. And thank you for shining your light on this world.
Oh, I love shining my light. It's so much fun.
Exactly. Thank you, Rachel.
You're welcome.
That was Rachel Gray. We had such a good time together. What an incredible individual. There's so many parts of that interview that moved and inspired me. The part at the end, when I said, thank you for shining your light in this world, she goes, it's so much fun. That is such a great response. It should be so much fun because all of us have light to share in this world. And if we realized that and understood it, we would realize that the power of what each and every one of us can bring to this world. This week, there is going to be a great program on Sunday, March 7th at 11 a.m. It's the behind the scenes with Jewish rapper Nissim Black, an event. It's Nissim, the rapper, is taking place. It's in partnership with Hineni and H.com, a special event for families focusing on bar and bar mitzvah boys and girls who missed it through COVID. Tune in and we will get you, if you check this out over here, go to H.com/Nissim and you're able to see it. And I think you actually can get a special shout out from him for those kids who missed their bar mitzvah. So you may want to check that out this week, and it should be a great program. It is now time for Kahoot. So please download the app. Oh, it's too late by now. So you should have the app already. Open it up. Get the webpage on. We're about to play Kahoot right now. And please throw in, if you have a couple more minutes, get me your shout outs. We'd love to hear from you. As we load Kahoot, remember it's 702-8116, 702-8116. We'll get Kahoot going right now. Everyone, give it a couple minutes to get everybody signed on. Shabbat shalom to Henya from Toronto. Shabbat shalom to RM, who I see is already logged on and getting ready to play. To Joan Kodesh, Shabbat shalom. Thanks so much. To the Novaks from Toronto, thank you. To the Levin family in Southfield, Michigan, Shabbat shalom. Lisa Mervitz, Shabbat shalom to the Mervitz family in Philadelphia. Rivka Tyler in Baltimore, Shabbat shalom to you. 702-8116. 702-8116. We'll give everybody another minute to get onto Kahoot. Gabby Keston from Queens, Shabbat shalom. Shabbat shalom to Reba Austrich. Shabbat shalom, and a special shout out to the Haas community. Shabbat shalom to Howard Chesterfield from H. St. Louis. Shabbat shalom to you. Shabbat shalom to Eric Hirsch and the Hirsch family. Okay, everybody, let's get rolling with Kahoot. We'll keep continuing on Shabbat shaloms, but let's get rolling. I see some of our usuals are back. Some new ones are here. This is going to be a great game. Let's get going. Shabbat shalom. Here he goes. Kahoot time. Okay. Maimonides defines 8 levels in giving charity, which is the highest level. When one gives less than he should, but cheerfully. When one gives directly to the poor without being asked. When one helps the poor find the means to support themselves. Or when one gives assistance anonymously, which is the highest level according to Maimonides. Shabbat shalom to John in Oxfordshire, England. Shabbat shalom to Safta, Susie, and Josh. Shabbat shalom to Beth Z. 2 seconds left in the first question. No, it's if you find somebody the means to support themselves. Wow, most people had the anonymous question. Let's see what happens to the board. Here goes Browns Rock. I think that's a playoff. I think someone's trying to pick a fight with Patriots Rock. Mervis family on the board. Zena K, SBG, and Ash. Okay, let's get rolling. Question number 2. What does amen mean or amen? I affirm, I understand, awesome, or a man, as opposed to a woman. What does amen mean? I affirm, I understand, awesome, or a man. Let's get to some more. A lot of love coming for Rachel Gray. Rachel, if you're watching this show, I want you to know there's a lot of comments from your interview. So congratulations, you did an amazing job. The answer is I affirm. Well, that was okay. We're going to make a note for the staff. We got to make these harder. And I'm sorry for the one who picked I understand, but they probably got bounced. Okay, let's see what happens to the board here. Browns Rock stays on. Mervis family, Zena, SBJ, and Sarah steps in. Let's go to question number 3. A Torah scroll may not be used even if it is only missing a letter, a word, a paragraph, or a column. What invalidates a Torah scroll from use? Shabbat shalom to Mark and Michelle Mandelman. Shabbat shalom. Let's see who else is up here. To the Gutstein family from Passaic, Shabbat shalom to you. What invalidates a Torah scroll? The answer is a letter. Wow. The crew is ripping up over here. Let's see how we do. Browns Rock stays on top. Mervis family, Zena, SBG, and Sarah. Okay, this is it. Final question. This is the final lap. Which two universities have Hebrew words in their seals? Columbia and Yale, Oxford and Cambridge, Texas A&M and Caltech, or Harvard and Princeton? Which two universities have Hebrew let words in their seals? Shabbat shalom to Zahav from Brooklyn. To Tikva, Shabbat shalom to you. Who's got Hebrew words in their seals? 7 seconds left for the final Kahoot game of this week. 3 seconds, last one. Here goes. The answer is Columbia and Yale. Columbia and Yale, lots of Harbors and Princetons. Let's see what this did to our leaderboard. Let's see who won this week's Kahoot. Third place, Ari Mack came out of nowhere, wasn't on the leaderboard until now. Z also came out of nowhere. Let's see who took this home. Zena K. Wow. The leaders got knocked out completely. Novak and Gittel, great game, everybody. You see, you got to watch Kahoot to the end. You can't leave Kahoot early because I got to tell you, you think the leaders are going to stay leaders. It's a good lesson in life, by the way. You never know. You never know. You got to keep on playing to the last bit. Congratulations to our winners. Go to projectinspire.com. And they'll get you some good gifts. And thank you so much for playing Kahoot today. Our next guests are Rabbi Aryeh and Rebbetzin Brenda Sokoloff. They're the Rabbi and Rebbetzin of the Kew Gardens Synagogue in Kew Gardens, New York. Rabbi Sokoloff is also a teacher of Jewish studies in Shevach High School of Queens and lectures for various organizations. Rabbi and Rebbetzin Sokoloff are the proud parents of 4 children, the youngest of which, Surly, has Down syndrome. After several years of parenting Surly, Mrs. Rebbetzin Sokoloff went back to school for her master's in special education and is currently working with preschool children. Rabbi and Rebbetzin, thank you so much for joining us on the show today.
Thank you.
Thank you, and good evening.
Good evening to both of you, and thanks for joining us. So share with us a little bit about Cerulli. When you found out that he was Downs, what he has done for your family, and give us a little bit of the insight of being parents of a special needs child.
Oh, well, Cerulli was a high-risk pregnancy, and there was a lot of testing and monitoring that took place. And about halfway through, a number of markers indicated a consistency with Down syndrome. And when we were informed about that, basically, we were just devastated. There were just so many feelings that went through us, so many emotions. What you just highlighted the last 25 minutes or so, that was not the world that we grew up in. In the world that we grew up, we didn't see children with special needs. I don't know where they were. They may have been shut away. Maybe they were never born. I don't really know. We didn't see them. And there were a lot of misconceptions, and there was a lot of ignorance. And we were led to believe that these children were not educable, that they had a short life expectancy, that they would destroy the family fibers, that destroy marriages. It was just devastating. It was frightening. We didn't know what to expect. And we worried about the impact that this would have on our children. And I guess most importantly, we anticipated, because of the way we were brought up, we anticipated a life of isolation for this child. We didn't know about all the strides that had been made at that point. We didn't know about a Camp Hask and all the organizations that we were exposed to. So we just anticipated that this child would have no life.
And what have you found? I mean, what an amazing evolution, I think. Just think about the world where it is today, and I guess the world where it was. How have you watched that develop for you and for Cerulli? You know, as he grew up in your home and as the world around you, I guess, sort of, either, like you said, either came to light or developed around you.
Well, we became aware of, we discovered that there is an incredible world out there of chesed, an unbelievable world of chesed that we were completely unaware of. And it was just amazing. We saw so much good. We saw so much incredible kindness. We saw chesed. We discovered heroes in the world of special needs that we never, ever would have been exposed to without having a young child by the name of Cerulli. And it was something that made an incredible impact upon us. And it just incredible, and just an unbelievable effect upon the way in which we learned about the world of chesed and how to deal with Cerulli.
And how has Cerulli impacted your life in incredible ways? You both of you, you should only know, are role models. As I'm sitting here speaking to you, the comments are coming up about the impact you made on other people. It's unbelievable. Live, this is happening live. I'm sure that Cerulli's impact on you enabled you to impact others. So share with us a little bit about Cerulli's impact on your family and what that and how that's changed you as parents and as role models.
Well, I can tell you the following. I've had many teachers, and in my years of education, I've studied many books of ethics. But I want you to know that my Rebbe, my teacher, is Cerulli. Wow. He taught me about life, that things that I probably never would have absorbed, never would have able to fully experience. He compelled us. He taught us what it means to love unconditionally. He taught us how to be sensitive. He taught us how to be patient, how to be non-judgmental. He taught us how to be accepting. He turned us into better parents. He turned this into, he made me a better rabbi. He made me a better teacher because he taught us how to genuinely find the good in other people, to appreciate the child, in order for us to be the parents that he needed us to be. We needed to understand him, and we needed to elevate our game so that we could ultimately provide for him what he needs.
I think also it impacted our family in a tremendous way because our children were still young, and watching him struggle, watching everything that came so naturally to them be such a struggle for him, made them understand that their strengths, their accomplishments, they were not a right that's given to everybody at birth. They were God-given gifts, and they needed to appreciate that. And it made them more appreciative. It made them more sensitive. And they've become, thank God, Baruch Hashem, outstanding human beings who are sensitive, who are caring, who are loving, who are non-judgmental, who are who give to their communities, and they chose spouses with the same characteristics. And now we're watching our grandchildren grow up so differently than we did because they've been exposed to their uncle Srili, and they've gone to see Camp Ask, and they've just become more sensitive children as a result of it.
Wow.
So we're very proud of everybody.
Oh, it's so wonderful. I have no words to respond to how inspiring both of you are and how I feel right now in listening to your perspective. I have no words. Thank you for sharing it. Before I let you go, tell us where Srili is and what he's up to. Just give us a little bit about him, and so that we could sort of, in some way, connect to him into where he is in life.
Well, Srili right now has pretty much finished his formal education. He attends a dayhem, and we're hoping for his future. We're hoping that he will at some point be able to have some form of vocational experience in his life. That's what we're hoping for. And as far as our general hopes for his future, I must tell you, our hopes for him are no different than the hopes that any parent has for a child. We want him to be able to reach his potential. We want him to be able to be a contributing member of society. He has an ability to bring such incredible joy and happiness to people. I've watched it and I'm overwhelmed by it. He has a fan club that's, we speak about a mile long. I would say it's much more than a mile long. So many people who love him. There's a world out there of people who really do love him. And we know that he's made an impact upon their lives as much as they've had on his life. And we're just hoping. We have hope and optimism for Srili's future. And he's going to make his mark. He will make his mark. He will make his mark on the world, and he'll make an impact upon people as he already does.
I'm absolutely sure. I just want you to know the comment sections here of the Srili fan club are blowing up as you're speaking. So in case we ever thought otherwise, as you're talking, Srili fans are popping up. They're coming out of the wood. We never had them before. We have them now. So we thank all of them that are here. Michael, Sarah, Reba, there's so many people that are jumping into this. And I like I say, I have no words. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for your perspective. We thank you for shedding light on all of our lives here. And as much as Srili has taught you something incredible about life, you have in turn shared it with all of us. Many people in this room that are watching tonight may not have ever had the interactions that you've had. And so we are better for it. And we thank you both. And thank you for your time. And thank you for shining your light on this world.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
For everything you do.
Yes. And thank you for being a counselor in Gambit. Yeah.
Thank you both. And good Shabbos to both of you.
Good Shabbos. Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom. Thank you so much. And that was unbelievable. This is exactly the people that we are blessed with in the world that make the world, I believe, a better place. And so it's an honor to have them on. And we thank the Rav and the Rebbetzin for doing that. And Srili, wherever you are, you're doing an amazing job. So keep it up. And to all the Srilis that are out there, you are bringing joy, light, and love to your family. And I want you to know that. There's an incredible video that I had a chance to see earlier that I want to share with you right now that was made. But just for the record, there are lots of amazing organizations, like I said, lots and lots and lots. It just happens to be that we're very much connected to Camp Hask, and they've been very much of a contributor to the show, and we thank them for that. But there's so many other organizations as well. I want to just give mention to all of them. But this next video, I think you're really going to like. It's called This Is We. Check this out.
I am not a stranger to the dark. Hide away, they say, 'cause we don't want your broken parts. I've learned to be ashamed of all my scars. Run away, they say, no one will love you as you are. Don't let them break you down to dust. I know that there's a place for us. We are warriors. When you feel afraid and you're full of doubt, we're gonna send the love, we're gonna shout it out. I am brave, I am free, take my hand and follow me. This is we.
Look out, 'cause here we come. And we're marching on to the beat we drum. We're not scared to be seen. We make no apologies. This is we. Come celebrate and let the games begin. No time to waste, 'cause today you'll find where you fit in.
Together we can beat the odds and give it all we got.
We are warriors.
We found where we belong.
Don't let them break it down to dust. I know that there's a place for us. We are warriors.
When you feel afraid and you're full of doubt, we're gonna send the love, you're gonna shout it out. Take my hand and follow me. This is we. Look out, 'cause here we come. And we're marching on to the beat we drum. We're not scared to be seen. We make no apologies. This is we.
Shout it out.
I am brave, I am free. Take my hand and follow me. This is we.
That was This Is We. The song I think I cut off a little bit at the end, but you can go to our website and check it out, or just Google it or YouTube it or whatever. I think the song is absolutely stunning. And to be honest, I'm trying to hold back all the emotions that I feel right now, I'm telling you. And just thank you for all the comments that are coming in as to what the special needs community is doing for you personally. It's unbelievable that what we're seeing and hearing from all the people that are emailing right now and commenting on all the impact that the special needs community has had on their life. It's really, really beautiful. Our next guest is an incredible individual. Her name is Bracha Lavrinoff. She's a certified international life coach, holds a master's degree in rehabilitation counseling. She has held positions in HASC as a parent support coordinator, coordinating and running parent support groups, Maimonides Infants and Children's Hospitals, Brooklyn, New York, as a family consultant. That includes training and education of residents and nurses and communicating with patients and their families. She's a mother of 10 children. One of her children passed away from a rare physical illness, and during that ordeal became a mother of a daughter with Downs. This combination of experiences gifted her with a level of understanding and a strong empathy that prompted her to become a life coach. Bracha, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it. Good Erev Shabbos to everybody out there.
Good Erev Shabbos. Thank you so much for joining us. Now, you've had a pretty heavy load reading your bio, and I'm sure it's missing a whole bunch of details and a lot of emotions, which sounds like you are incredibly suited to give genuine direction for people looking for that level of support. What do you do? What do you say? How do you counsel people to find strength that they never knew that they had when encountering the challenges that they come their way?
Yeah, so I think that that's a really important question. Thank you for asking it. You know, it's important to understand that not all of us are born with, that we know we have strength, and sort of when we're put into certain situations, we're given kind of like a chance to shine in ways that we haven't before, or to develop certain skills that we didn't know that we had. That comes directly from God. God gives us an experience and we live with it, we live through it, and we take from it and we grow from those experiences.
So yeah, I want to delve in with you because I mean, I feel like you're like the expert in it. Like, and I was saying, like, we have you here. Like, we got to like delve into this because it doesn't matter the challenge. I am positive that me and everyone watching this, whenever they get whatever challenge comes their way, is like, I can't do that. I can't do that. And I'm sure you get that. Or I'm sure when you walk in and after the one or two rounds, they're like, no, I'm sorry, you don't know me. I can't do that. So where does a person go? Like, where do they find it? So that they can tap the well that is prepared for them by God of the strength that they need to become the greatest they can be in every situation.
So for me, it was a little bit of a story because I got my master's degree in rehabilitation counseling and was working with adults who had disabilities way before I ever had my own children. And this was something, you know, I always wanted to work in Camp Task, but they had such a long waiting list of people who wanted to work there that I didn't get the chance and the opportunity to do it. So, you know, I guess Hashem gave me the opportunity. God gives, you know, the opportunity at some other point to take care of children with special needs. In this case, it happens to have been my own. Drawing upon the tools that I had from my educational opportunity, I was kind of, that was extra tools in my pocket when I was given my own challenges to deal with later in life.
Wow. And when you see people realize it, what is that like? You know, you're working with people and I'm sure they think they can't, and then they can.
I start at all different stages. Sometimes I meet somebody who gives birth to a baby with special needs and they know right away, and I'll go bedside to a hospital room to sit with them and to give them support from day one. When people have the right kind of support, they can get through almost anything, even very, very hard challenges. If somebody's carrying a very heavy load and somebody comes and helps them carry that load automatically becomes easier for them to carry.
That's an amazing concept. So let's talk about that for a second. How does someone help others best, right? How, can someone be supportive in a way that is helpful to somebody else carrying a load like this or any other loads that you are counseling for?
Sure. Okay. That's very important. One thing that I just need to say is that when I speak from the years of getting feedback from other parents. I'm sure I do not represent every parent out there who has children with special needs or who are going through other challenges. So that's kind of important to stick in there. That I'm just going according. I've been running support groups for about 13 years, also through HASC Center. So, you know, I know the show is not about HASC, but HASC has done so much for the community. And I was lucky enough to work for them for all these years doing support groups. And I think that it's important to know a few things. If you're a family member, if you're a good friend of somebody who has a child with special needs, when did you come into their lives? Were you a family member or a friend of the family before the child was born? And then the child was born, you know, you were there for the birth, or did you become a friend, or did you come into the family when the child was, when the parents were already seasoned in taking care of their child with special needs? So that's a very important thing to kind of be aware of. You know, what could we do for them? How do we offer support? We can actually, most important thing to do with a family who's going through having a child with special needs is to say to them, what is it like to live a day in your life? Tell me a story. Give me an example of how it's challenging for you. Parents like to talk about their experiences. They like people to hear them. It's healing, it's therapeutic. That's one way.
Amazing, 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 amazing. And I think to your point, by just being there for somebody else, what I love about this bit of advice that I think is counterintuitive, but incredibly important, is that no one in support, you don't have to solve anything. You have to, like you said, and the example I think is really important of carrying, which is sometimes being an ear for somebody else and being a friend and listening to what they want to say, I think is most people, I don't think, know how to do that. I think we want to solve stuff. But I think what you're saying, which is a real takeaway in every scenario, is that one way you can be there for somebody else is by actually listening to what they want to say and being there to hear it.
It's very important to understand that the family, you know, yes, there are practical things that we can do spiritually, physically, and emotionally to help them through whatever it is, but you need to ask them, you know, it's even okay to say, I don't know how to be supportive of you right now. Mm-hmm. I don't know what you need to hear. I don't know what I can say, but I want to be there for you. Here are some realistic, practical things that I can do in order to help you. Maybe even a nice idea is on the child's birthday, bring them an iced coffee, give them a gift certificate for a husband and wife to go out and have a little respite for the evening. Give, you know, self-care something the parents of kids with special needs are lacking. Give them a gift of a massage or just something that helps them get through their day and know that they're cared about. And every child is challenging, even typical children are challenging. And I think that that's, you know, that we tend to think that it's only children with special needs that are challenging. Typical ones are too. Sometimes we have a harder time with those that have a disability.
Amazing. Well, Bracha, thank you so much for joining us on the show today. Thanks for what you do for the entire community and shining your light on this world.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you. Shabbat Shalom. And that was an incredible, incredible person, incredible interview. And thank you so much for being on this show. And what can I say? What can I say? You know, one of the things that struck me was earlier in the show, when Rebbetzin Sokolov mentioned this idea that when she first gave birth to Cerulli, the lack of knowledge, the lack of understanding. This is what this show is all about. It's about understanding each other. It's appreciating who we are as a community and as a people. And what it means to me and what I learned when I was in camp, when I was involved in Yachad, when I have the opportunity to go to other places to see the work that's being done, in the other great organizations across the country, is this idea that every single one of us is a world. We each are a piece of God. And every single human being is the most special human being in the world. The recognition that no one is better than another. And accepting, as Rabbi Judah said, and appreciating people for who they are. And learning what each one can teach us about ourselves. I love when Rabbi Sokolov said that his son certainly makes him a better rabbi. He does. But to recognize that, we bring out the best in each other. And we all have our own needs. And there's no race. And there's no one person who is in front of another. We are all the same in the eyes of Hashem. And God looks at each and every one of us and loves us for who we are. And when we're able to see that in each other, we start to see that in ourselves. That's the power of seeing the greatness in everybody. And that's, I believe, what the special needs community brings out in us. It's the entire community. And the ability to celebrate them is the ability to celebrate us. In many ways, that's what Shabbat is all about. The Shabbat show isn't just tangentially related to these topics. It's critically related, because it's those moments where God slows the world down that he reframes us, where he reminds us of why we're here, where he reminds us of how he wants us to see the world, where the world that we grew up in starts to fade away, and the world that is inside us starts to change our lenses, and we start to look at the world differently. We start to appreciate the things that are in our lives. We become more sensitive. We become more appreciative. And we start to realize that each individual is put onto this world for a reason. Me and you, our greatest gift is that we are a representative of the creator of humanity. That's the greatest thing that we have, is a piece of God inside us. And when we realize it in ourselves and we see it in others, we live very, very different lives. We're still in this world, but we live different lives. And that's what we aspire to. That's what we need to aspire to. And it doesn't matter if the world around us doesn't seem like it's getting it. And it doesn't matter if the world around us seems like they're killing each other. It don't matter. What matters is that me and you can be a little bit better. Me and you can try a little bit harder. See the person down the block. No matter what they look like on the outside, for who they are on the inside. And if all we do is change our families, our communities, or even ourselves, we've done a lot. I learned that in Camp Ask. I learned that in Yachad. I learned that from the special needs community. And I hope that we today are a little bit more sensitive, a little bit greater, and we can walk away with the commitment to see each other a little bit greater, to appreciate what we have and appreciate who we are. Don't forget, this Tuesday night, we got MindFlex coming up. It's about relationships, 5 ideas that can transform your relationships through Rabbi Shlomo, Rebbe and Devorah Buxbaum. That's Tuesday, marriage, Wednesday, parenting. You don't want to miss that. And on behalf of me and mine to you and yours, it's that time of week. I love this time. I don't know about you. Thursday night. It's almost here. It's almost here. I want to wish you a great Shabbos. Shabbat Shalom. May you realize how awesome you are. May you realize how lucky we are to be born in the image of God. May we realize that our eyes can see the greatest in people if we let it. And may we realize that we are one people. And when we see the greatness in each other, we'll find it in ourselves. May this be a Shabbat that shows us all of those things and more. And I hope and pray that next week we get to do this live from Jerusalem. But if not, we hope to see you next week right here. So wishing you all an amazing weekend a good Shabbos, and a Shabbat Shalom.
We together call it I do. Shoot, but every generation they take one raising the haters, then I shimmy the pavement, blazing to save us. Then the world asks where they went. Patience are faithless. The Torah gave the whole world a facelift. If hatred is baseless, we take it, erase it, and exchange it for that master goal. We don't forget wherever we may go. There is only one place we know, and it's called Zero.
You pieces and you're just falling down, falling down. I'll pick you up, and if you feel like you're outnumbered, I'll